In all I do, I honor you. I hate to say this, but I'm a liar. Because not everything that I do honors God. And it's not on purpose either. It's just the consequences of life. But our goal and our desire is to honor God in all things that we do. And he said that it's possible to do that, but I've got to keep my mind focused and I've got to keep my eyes on things that matter. Paul said he, if he ever would have repeated those exact words, would have been a liar also, because he said, I keep doing things that I don't want to do. Now that's the nature of living in a carnal flesh and blood body. But one day the Lord said, we're not going to be limited to these flesh and blood bodies, and we're still going to be able to think. What if I told you there was nothing you could do wrong? You could do anything you want, and it would not be sin unless you changed the air vent back there. That's the only thing in all the world. I was being silly about that. What they were told in the Garden of Eden was, you can do anything you want to except eat of this apple. Or it wasn't an apple, I'm sorry. I hate to put words in there, you know. We know that Jonah was swallowed by a whale. I'm kidding, it wasn't a whale, it was a big fish. But it wasn't an apple either, but it was a fruit of some type. It was a fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. If I told you you could do whatever you want, that means that if you wanted to do anything that they did was not sin in God's eyes, because there's only one thing that was called sin, and that was, don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the garden. Now, we have choices since then, but there are a lot of things that God calls sins. There are things that he had laid out for us in the scripture, and he said that concerning the Ten Commandments, if anybody says that he is without sin or has not committed the Ten Commandments, he is a liar or a lawyer. Those sound so close together. I'm not sure which one of those are applicable. No, I'm a liar, not lawyer. That would not be right. Listen, 2 weeks ago, I talked about then a verse that's found in your bulletin in Romans chapter 8, 28. And that verse says, we know that in all things, even in the bad things of life, the trials of life and the sins that you walk through and I walk through, God works for good to those who love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose. That means that even though I stumble over things at times within my life, and you do too, it's natural, and you're not broken. You're exactly the way God made you, and you're not any greater sinner than anybody who's ever lived. Your temptations, your struggles, and the things that you willingly continue to do are no worse than anybody else's. Now, you feel like they are sometimes when the Holy Spirit is sitting on your heart, because he's got a lot of weight sitting on my chest sometimes. But when we ask forgiveness of those things, it's like that weight is lifted off. Have you ever felt like your shoulders just felt lighter? Have you ever felt like you just had a freedom and you could run and not get weary? You could encourage. You know, when I felt like that most of the time, it has to do with right after I've done something in service for the Lord. When I'm walking through the trials, I have to realize that trials are going to be here. But the Bible literally said and promised from the Holy Spirit, because all scripture is God-breathed. There's a passage in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 that says all scripture is God-breathed. Paul said, or Peter said himself, that there's no prophecy of scripture in 2 Peter chapter 1. There is no scripture that comes about by man's interpretation. So all of the words that are in this book were inspired by God, by the Holy Spirit. And that's what the scripture says. These words were written down or spoken from God as prophets, individuals, men and women were carried along by the Holy Spirit to pen them down. So it's a fact that God works for good, but God defines good as something that prepares us for heaven. Now, this is all kind of introductory from a sermon 2 weeks ago. Remember, the verse doesn't say that God causes all things to happen. Did God cause bad things to happen? No. Did he allow it? Yes. If he did not allow it, we would not have choice. But he did not cause those things to happen. Instead, he takes those circumstances of life and causes good to come from those things. I love that. But there's a condition to his promise. It works for the good to those who love him and are called according to his purpose. And being called according to his purpose is a process that the scripture calls sanctification, of becoming more like Christ. So if we become more like Christ through our lifetime, then this conforming to the image of the Son is a molding process, a process of us like being put into the hands of a clay worker, or a person who, what is a person who is a potter, who makes vessels of honor or vessels of dishonor, if you would, in that way. In other words, the promise applies to individuals who are being conformed to the image of his Son. And the good news is, ultimately in glory, even the trials or the bad things of life are going to work together for good. There are individuals who are still missing their loved ones and wondering what happened to that Malaysian airliner that went down. And they're saying, how could good come from that? How could a plane, a whole airplane, be lost? Now, you might have thought that years ago that could have taken place, you know, a ship go down at sea and we don't know where it went down. But today, how could those things take place with the abilities that we have today and the electronics today? And yet it did take place. But one day, we will understand. And it's not like if a child dies, please don't go to the parents and say, well, God took your child because he knew your kid was going to turn out to be mean or something like that. That's not the way it is. Death and destruction, bad things, do not come from God. God is the author of good and he's the author of light, but he uses those things from the one who comes to steal, kill, and destroy, Satan, give the devil his due. He uses those things somehow to try us, to sharpen us and to strengthen us, like a sword going through a hot, hot fire, and it comes out stronger and it comes out sharper. And one day we will understand. There's a verse that, or a song that says, trials dark on every hand and we cannot understand how all the ways that God will lead us through the something promised land. But he'll guide us with his eye. Oh, shoot. I guess I'd have to, I don't remember how words. Trials dark on every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways that God will lead us to that blessed promised land. But he'll guide us with his eye, and we'll follow till we die. And then what does it say? We will understand it better by and by. We'll understand it better by and by. That's the promise that God gives us. And the good news that he gives for us is that one day those things are going to be understood better and better. So today, take out your bulletin or take out your Bible. Today we're going to look at Romans chapter 8, verse 29. If all things work together for good, the verses that follow this, that are the most controversial verses since the 1600s on college campuses and in seminaries across this land. There is an individual named John Calvin who I think was from the 1600s. I didn't look up those dates, but I'm certain that he was from the 1600s. He put together this thought based upon this scripture that deals with a word that is called predestined, that's only found in two places in the Bible, in Romans chapter 8 and Ephesians chapter 1. And he thought that that meant that some people were destined to be saved and some people were destined to go to hell. And God knows who is who. And so God created mankind, and he knew that these individuals that were going to be born as a baby were going to grow up and reject him. Knowing that they were going to go to hell, he created these children and adults to be born and to grow up knowing they were going to go to hell. Now, the problem with that is it doesn't fit with other scriptures, and I'm going to talk about those things today. The God's blueprint for mankind is found in this place here, but a prideful individual would say, this is talking to us Christians, and to those hell-bound sinners, it's not talking to. That's not true, because God is calling everyone, and the scripture is going to be clear about that. What I desire by God's grace today, if you have been an individual who have studied the works of John Calvin, there are many good works. This one is not. There are some people who are so married to his theory on this verse that they call themselves Calvinist. And JC does not stand for Jesus Christ. They're more committed to John Calvin than Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ said, "It's not my desire that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him." And you have to take those scriptures out of the Bible if you're going to think that God knows who is going to be, or God has chosen who's going to be saved and who's not. And I'll show you these proofs of this. Look at Romans chapter 8, verse 29. God's blueprint for mankind is what I titled this sermon. You're going to hear that a couple of times today. Romans 8, 29 says, God works to good all those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Verse 28, then 29 says, because or for, which means this is an explanation of how God works things for good. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters or brethren. Now, who can understand the knowledge of God? I asked that last week, I think, or at least I thought it. Nobody can understand the knowledge of God. Job asking in Job chapter 38, he was asking God, why do these terrible things happen to me? Why do bad things happen to me? Because I was a righteous man. I was doing my best to live for you. And even God called him a righteous man. But terrible things happened, and he lost his children. He lost his homes. He had sores and boils all over his body. Why would those bad things happen to a good person? When he asked God, God answered him. There's nothing wrong with you asking God or questioning God. To blame God means that you're blaming the wrong person. Blame the devil for the bad things. But when the Lord gave him an answer, God said, I'm going to give you a perspective. Instead of just answering your question, Job, I'm going to broaden your mind. And once God broadened Job's mind, Job went, I should have never even asked the question. I was thinking in a nutshell, in a peanut. I was thinking with a very limited tunnel vision perspective, and I didn't realize God's perspective. Here's what God said in Job chapter 38 when Job asked him all of these questions. The Lord answered Job out of a storm, and God said, who is it that darkens my counsel in chapter 38 verse 2? Who is it that darkens my counsel with words without knowledge? You're speaking without a perspective. Job, your perspective is teeny-weeny, and my perspective is universal. It is beyond the universe that are out there. And we're thinking that we can figure out God with a finite mind, and yet God is infinite, which means it doesn't end. Who asked these words without knowledge? He said, brace yourself like a man, and I will question you, and you're going to answer me something, Job. Where were you whenever I laid the earth's foundations? Tell me if you understand, Job. Who marked off the dimensions of the universe? Who stretched it out with a measuring line across it? Who laid its cornerstone? Who shut up the sea behind doors? When it burst forth from the womb, the sea blew forth. But God said, no farther are you going to go. He said, I made clouds as a garment for the sea, and I wrapped it in thick darkness. When I fixed its limits for it, I set doors and bars in place that it could not go farther. And I said, this far you may come and no farther. He said that to the sea so we could live on dry land. Have you ever given orders to the morning, Job, God asked, or shown the dawn its place that it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it? The earth takes shape like a clay. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea? The things that God listed and named in here, they had never seen or heard of before. They never realized that at the bottoms of the sea, that there were springs that gushed forth from it. Some of the scientific things concerning oceanography were founded and grounded out of questions that are found in the book of Job. And yet God knew it, and he said it years before. Before mankind figured out around 1850, through the father of oceanography, who figured out that there were streams or rivers or flow patterns in the middles of the sea, and if ships would go out of the bank areas that they were comfortable into these flow patterns, and they would be able to get to their destination much faster. Why? Because there were rivers or seas that were like flowing through the middle of the ocean, that there were springs that came out of it. There are so many details of these things that Job was going, I didn't realize that. I didn't know that. I didn't think these things. I wasn't there, God. Were you there whenever I set the stars in place and named each one of them, God said? And Job said, no. Now, How do we know that all things work together for good? Because we have a limited perspective and God's perspective is broad. That's kind of what he wanted to let us know concerning those things. But how can we know the knowledge of God? Because there are some people that says, I know what God knows. So those God foreknew, he knows who's going to be saved and who's not going to be saved. The foreknowledge of God we've figured out, I guess, but I'm going to ask him some questions. The scripture says in Romans 11:33, who has known the mind of the Lord? Who has become God's counselor? 1 John 3:20 says, God knows everything, and he even knows what's in your heart. In your heart, not just in your mind, but in the seat of your emotions. You see, some people have their mind fixed on who I am and what I am. God really knows who we are and what we are. We sometimes have lied to ourselves, but God knows. He knows the innermost being of every individual. God knows. Psalm 147:5 says, God's understanding is infinite. So the things that I've said, I've tried to base on Scripture. In other words, God's understanding is not having to grow. He doesn't have to grow in wisdom and stature and knowledge until he came into this earth as a baby, as a child, and he had to grow at that point. But God's wisdom just does not stop. It always is. Somehow the scripture is telling us that God is all-knowing. And so what did he foreknow about God? If God knows all things, couldn't he know who was going to be saved one day and who was going to go to hell? And if he was going to know who was going to be saved and go to hell, why would he let that baby be born? Or why would he let that baby live past the age of accountability? Because he did. Because there are many people, and you could name some of them, and I hate to put names on, but I'm thinking about mass murderers or people who have done terrible things, because I could assume that they're not saved unless they put their faith in Jesus Christ, and I know that the only unpardonable sin is to reject Christ. So I don't know what took place before they died or whatever. But the fact is that if God foreknew those things, why would he let those things take place? Here's a passage in Ephesians chapter 1. The only two places in the Bible that this word predestined is talked about is in Romans chapter 8 and Ephesians 1. I want you to turn to Ephesians 1 if you have your Bible. If not, listen close. Ephesians 1, I'm going to read verse 3 through 14, portions of it. Ephesians 1, 3 says, praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He blessed us in the heavenly realms from the beginning with every spiritual blessing in Christ. In other words, the blessings only come from and through and in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. Now, we who are Christians would say he chose us Christians, and those dirty, rotten, wicked, evil, mean, and nasty sinners he did not choose. He only chose us because we're better than them. Would we say that? Could we say that God chose us as Christians because we smell better or speak a better language or look better or have more money or are smarter? We can't say that. We can't say that at all, because the scriptures that God said about his love for all mankind. So before the creation of the world, God had these things going on in his mind. He went, the angels have messed up. And a third of those stars of heaven, or a third of the angels, have fallen from heaven with Lucifer. I created a group called the angels, and a third of them said, we want to be in charge of this place. They set up this coup to overthrow God, and God said, I'm going to throw you out. And he did those things. God stepped back, and somehow the scripture is telling us that his foreknowledge said, I'm going to create a people. I'm going to create a mankind. I'm going to create men and women who I'm going to give them the choice. I'm going to give them the choice. I'm going to make it so easy that I'm going to do all of the work. I'm going to pay the price. But if they will make the choice, then I will make them my family. See, the angels weren't his family in the same way. They couldn't be. They would never be co-heirs with Christ. They would never be joint heirs with Jesus. But we've been given that opportunity, the scripture says. So God chose us in him before the creation of the world. Who, us Christians? No. But Paul was speaking personally about it. He said, I know this Father personally. I know this Daddy in heaven personally. I know I was chosen. And he was speaking from that perspective. Before the creation of the world, through God's foreknowledge, he set up what he was about to do. He set the blueprint, and that's the foreknowledge of God. That's all we can know about the knowledge of God, because I can't, with my limited mind, understand infinite wisdom. God created the world for all mankind. He didn't create mankind for the world, because the world wasn't the most important thing, because the world is going to be destroyed one day. He created mankind eternal, and the world is temporary, which means he created the world first for mankind. And then he said, I'm going to give this and make this the boot camp of life to give you the opportunity to become more like me and to choose me or reject me. I want you to choose ahead of time, because I don't want you to get to heaven like the angels did and go, no, we don't want to be this. He had that already. They messed up. And what they dropped, we are going to have the opportunity to step in, and that's the reign of the heavens. And so the things that God said concerning those things, that all who are in Christ one day would be blameless in his sight. Blameless only happens in Christ. So in love, verse 5 says, verse 4 and 5 of that passage in Ephesians 1 says, in love he predestined us for adoption to sonship. He set ahead of time. So through the foreknowledge of God, he said, I'm going to create mankind, and then he destined mankind to reign in the heavens. That's our destiny, but it's going to be your choice. Your destiny is to reign with Christ in heaven to the praise of his glorious grace, verse 6 says, which he has freely offered to us or given to us in the one that he loves, which is Jesus Christ. Listen close. It says, in Christ we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins only through his blood. We don't have that if we will not receive that. If we have not accepted Christ, we don't have forgiveness of sins. There's only one way to the Father, and that's through the Son. This is a mystery in his will. Verse 10 says to be put into effect when the times reach fulfillment. Those things have not even been in effect yet, because God is going to call all of his servants together who have chosen him, who have responded to his gift of salvation. He's going to lavishly pour out on us the opportunities, the blessings, and the responsibilities of eternity. Verse 11 says, in Christ, we were also chosen. We were chosen, having been predestined, because God set it up for mankind that way. According to the plan, it says we were predestined, having been predestined, according to the plan, which is the plan for mankind of him who works out everything in conformity to the process of his will. And then there's a conditional statement in verse 12 of Ephesians 1. It says, in order that we who were the first to put our hope in Christ might be, that's conditional, that we might be for the praise of his glory. I have a choice in my life whether to be for the praise of his glory or to bring him dishonor. And then he said in verse 13, and you also were included in Christ. Listen to this. If you're listening to this and you have this Calvinist mindset that says God chooses ahead of time who's going to be saved and who's going to go to hell, verse 13 of Ephesians 1 says, you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. You were not included in Christ until you responded to the message of Jesus Christ. You were not included. There wasn't a mark on you. In fact, it goes on to say, when you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. That mark didn't come before you believed. He didn't choose ahead of time who's going to be saved and who's going to go to hell. He left you the choice. He left you the choice. If he chose ahead of time, then he wouldn't say you were sealed after you responded when you believed and were marked with him. Now you've got a mark on you that God sees that covers all of your sins as if you have never sinned before. This mark is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession and the praise of his glory. When you believe, there was a mark that was put on you, and it's the Holy Spirit guaranteeing what is to come, guaranteeing your inheritance. There is no mark on people prior to their salvation to say who's going to be saved and who's not going to be saved. There's not a mark from God, the scripture says. And this is the Holy Spirit's pen that has written these things through an individual called Paul to the church at Ephesus. There is no mark on you that God says that one's going to be saved, that one's not. That one's going to be saved, that one's not. Verse 29, back to Romans chapter 8, verse 29, says, for those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. Now, I had to go again. 1 John 3:20 says, God knows everything. Who did God not foreknow? Who did God not forelove? I already told you, John 3:16, for God so loved the world. And that's not talking about the earth. It's talking about the world, the people. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life, if you'll put your faith and your trust in him. Whosoever, Y'all remember a hymn? I've felt a little bit musical over the last couple of Sundays. There was a song that said, oh, Jesus included me, yes, he included me. When the Lord said, whosoever, he included me. When he said, whosoever, he wrote it to who? Everybody. You're not left out of that. I'm too bad, God. I've got too much sin in my life. I got too much garbage. There's no way you'd want to save me. No, you are whosoever. When he said, whosoever believeth in me would not perish, does that actually mean that anybody who believes in him would not perish? Even terrible, wicked, evil, mean, and nasty sinners? Yes, even you. If you fit in that category like me. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 and 4. And I say these verses so you can go back and listen to them if you want to write them down. It says, God wants, in 1 Timothy 2, verse 3 and 4, God wants all mankind to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 says, the Lord is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but all to come to repentance. When God said all, did he mean all? Yes. When God said, it's not my desire that any one person, even the worst, evil, terrible sinner of this world, even the worst one, when he said all, I don't want that person to end up separated either. See, hell was not created for mankind. I talked about that last Sunday. Hell was created at the end of Matthew 25. You can read about it, at the end of the parable of the sheep and the goats. Hell was created for the devil and his angels. But those who want to follow the devil and his angels into hell, God said, I will leave that choice up to you. And if you want to do that, that is your destiny. But I'm going to give you an opportunity through Jesus Christ. And you can follow Christ into eternal life in heaven forever and ever. You can follow Jesus so that wherever Jesus is, there you will be. The very day that Jesus died on the cross, he said to that thief next to him, today you'll be with me in paradise. And that paradise is this place called the third heaven. Not the heaven that is our atmosphere that we could breathe in. Not the heaven that has the universe out there. But the place that we have never seen yet, unless you've died and come back and maybe got a glimpse. And some probably have. Because they've gotten to see into that spiritual world, and I've gotten to talk with individuals who've been there when their loved one is gone and the angels came and accompanied them, and they said, I see Mama waiting for me. I see Daddy. Rex Brooks said, I see him at the gate, and he was talking about his grandpa. I see him. And God desires for all mankind to see that and to experience that, and he made it so readily available that he gave his only begotten son that whoever would believe in him. Look now at the most controversial verses in Christian education, Romans chapter 8, verse 30. And it says, and those he predestined, who did he predestine? Mankind. Those he predestined, he called. He called all to be saved. The call of salvation is the outreach of God. The call isn't from you, it's to you. And everyone who responds to his call, the scripture says, and those he called, he justified. He paid the price. And those he justified, he glorified. Now, I'm going to explain these four things to you, and it won't take very long, but I wonder, I am not in my glorified body right now. If I was, I wouldn't have to wear these old rags called threads and clothing that we wear today. See, Adam and Eve, before they sinned and fell short of the glory of God, they were not naked. They didn't see themselves as naked. Though they had no clothes on, they somehow were clothed in the glory of God. Jesus showed us that glory on the Mount of Transfiguration. And one day, the scripture says in Revelation 19, we will be given white raiment, the glory of God to wear. Those eternal bodies, and not just an eternal resurrected body, but a glorified body. But this verse says it's already done. And it is already done spiritually. So listen to these words. God foreknew or envisioned. God said, the angels have messed up. I'm going to create a people that can be my family. He planned that ahead of time. It's through his foreknowledge that he planned ahead of time. And he said, those people that I'm going to create one day in his foreknowledge are going to fill up the heavens, and I'm going to make them co-heirs with Christ. They're going to be joint heirs with me. They're going to take over the role of the angels. And he destined mankind to take over the roles in heaven. That's what we are predestined to reign in the heavens. And those who he's given this opportunity, he's called. He said, now who of you would accept my son? Who would accept this gift of salvation? Those he foreknew, he destined for heaven, and he called you to respond. And everyone who responded to his call, he justified. Justified. He predestined mankind for this, and he justified. Acts 16:31 says, believe on the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved. He made it simple. Jesus paid the price. He completely paid the price, and on the cross he said, it is finished. There is no more price to be paid. So all mankind was predestined. All mankind was called, but not all of mankind has been saved, have they? Not all mankind is justified yet. But God is talking about this like it was his blueprint. It's his overall design. So God only justifies individuals the moment they're saved. Come in close to this. I hope you're not bored, because this is profound teaching, profound preaching, whether you realize it or not at this stage. It is. Romans chapter 3, verse 24 says, we're justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. We're justified by his grace. We're justified. Romans 3:28 says, therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith. See, it's by faith you have been saved through grace. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. It is by grace you have been saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God. We're justified by faith. Romans 5:1 says, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace from God. And we know that all things work together for good. Romans 5:9 says, much more than being now justified by his blood. You see, you're not justified until you receive the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. It says we have been justified by his blood, and we're going to be saved from the wrath of God through him. Titus 3:7 says that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs. See, because of the blood of Jesus Christ, justified by his grace, we're made heirs. We can reign with Christ. We are part of the inheritance of the heavens. And the last one in this section says, Acts 13:38 and 39, there says, therefore, my dear friends, I want you to know that through Jesus, the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. Through him, everyone who believes is set free from sin, a justification you are not able to obtain on your own, but only comes through Christ. You're not able to obtain through the law, is what it says. So here it is. All mankind was created by God, and through his foreknowledge, he said, I'm going to create mankind. I'm going to destine them to reign in the heavens. I'm going to call them to respond to this, and I'm going to justify all of those who would respond to my call. So all have been called, but not all are responding, have responded to Christ. So one of the men asked 2 weeks ago, what does it mean to be justified? It's simple. It's written right there in the Word. Justified means justified, never sinned before. God sees me just like I have never sinned. All of my sins are forgiven. My sins are washed away. If one of my sins was not forgiven, the ones in the past or the one tomorrow, if any of my sins were not forgiven, I couldn't make it into heaven, because garbage is not going to go into heaven. We have to be washed by the blood of the Lamb, and all of our sins are washed by the blood of the Lamb, and we have an opportunity to heaven. Being justified by his blood, being justified through faith in him, being justified by his grace means justified, never sinned before. Justified, never sinned. And everyone who responds to the gift of Jesus Christ is justified in him. That's the third word of that verse. The next word says, and those he justified, he also glorified. And this is a tough one. Though Satan wants us to focus on predestination, out of our prideful ignorance, we do that sometimes. Who's destined to be saved and who's not? I know that we are, because we're better than those other people. Prideful Christian. You're focusing on the wrong thing if you're focusing on predestination that has to do with an inheritance that God set up for us. It talks about firstborn and inheritance, but what God wants us to focus on is making sure that everyone is justified in him and spiritually already glorified. There is nothing unredeemed. There's nothing sinful about your spirit. Oh, there's still a battle going on in your soul. And the Word of God makes distinctions between the soul and the spirit, the joints and the marrow, the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. Hebrews 4:12 says, but there is nothing unredeemed in your spirit. The day you accept Jesus Christ, your spirit is whole and complete and redeemed in him. And the Holy Spirit bears witness with our spirit because it is pure. It's a place that the Holy Spirit can dwell. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17, to prove this out, says, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, complete freedom. And we all know, listen to verse 18 of 2 Corinthians 3, we all know that we with unveiled faces now reflect the Lord's glory, not our own glory. One day we'll reflect our glory that's been given to us, but we reflect somehow that peace that goes beyond understanding. We reflect the glory of the Lord, and we are being transformed into his image. It's a process. We are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory. It's growing and growing and growing in us because we're becoming more like Christ, and that comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. When you look in a mirror, you see your reflection, you see your face or your body in a mirror, but when you look into the Word of God, sometimes you see things that are not very pretty. You're not reflecting the Lord's glory. Sometimes I see my own sin, but if I will wash those things, I could either walk away from the mirror and go, ooh, I look ugly. I'm not going to look in that mirror the rest of the day. And you ever do that in the morning? You look in the mirror in the morning and you got all that ugly on your face and you're not shaving like I am most of the time. And you look at yourself and you go, oh, I look ugly. I know how to remedy that. I won't look in the mirror. What do other people still see in you? The garbage on your face and your hair all in with bedhead. You see, they see that you haven't fixed yourself up because you still got dirt. Spiritually, it's the same way. Some people go, I don't like the way I look in here, so I'm not going to look in here anymore. Everybody still sees your dirt. The reflection of the mirror of the Word of God is made for us to make us more like Christ. And it's a process, again, I told you at the beginning, called sanctification, a process that will be complete one day whenever we take our last breath on this earth and there's no more battle because the flesh is left behind between the flesh and the spirit and we become more like Christ and we spiritually take on his glory. John chapter 17, verse 20, Jesus was praying. He said, my prayer is not just for the disciples, but I pray also for all of you who believe. And Jesus was saying these words about me and you. I pray also for all those who believe in me. Verse 22 says, I have given them the glory that you gave me, Father. He was praying. He said, I've given Michael the glory that you've given me. I've given every individual who has been bought by the blood of the Lamb at the Cowboy Church of Ennis, the glory that you gave to me, Father. I am in them and you are in me. Verse 24 says, Father, I want those that you've given me to be with me forever where I am. I want them to see my glory because they will see the true glory that goes on forever and ever, a glory that they will taste one day, the glory that you've given me. We share in his glory the moment we're saved spiritually, but one day we're going to share in his physical glory also. We'll be fully clothed with him. In 2 Corinthians 5, verse 1 through 5, Paul said, I long to be clothed with my heavenly dwelling. For when I'm clothed with my heavenly dwelling, I will not be found naked. Until that time, while I'm in this tent of a body, I keep myself clothed with physical clothes so that my shameful nakedness will not be seen. But the fact is that one day I'm going to be completely engulfed in God all over. My armpits won't stink. My feet will smell like roses or golden roads or whatever it is. You see, God has the best for us. And I can't see that, but I can believe that because nothing that he said, he's ever gone back on his word for. There is glory in heaven and that white raiment will be given to us to wear. Revelation 19, 7 and 8 says, so here's the conclusion. Here's the done facts. That's God's blueprint for eternity. That through God's foreknowledge, I'm going to repeat it one last time. Through God's foreknowledge, he said, I'm going to create a people. And he created us. And he said, that people, they are going to be the ones who reign in the heavens. They are destined for that. They're predestined to reign with me in glory. And I'm going to call that people. And for all those who respond to the call, I will justify them just if they had never sinned before. And those who are justified through the blood of Jesus Christ, I'm going to glorify them and give them a taste of what eternity is going to be like. And one day I will make that complete. I'll call up those temporary bodies and make those mortal bodies immortal. And the last verses, verse 31 through 34, says, and it's his conclusion, what then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? The blueprint said he's called us and he's making it true. Our Father is always going to protect us. If our dad in heaven is for us, who can stand against God? The answer is no one. Verse 32 says, he who did not spare his own son but gave him up for you. He did not hold back Jesus Christ, his only son, but he gave him up for you. How will he not also, along with Jesus, graciously give out the rest of the things that he said? See, it was his plan ahead of time. It was his blueprint to send his son to redeem mankind, that all those who would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. And as sure as that took place and Jesus rose from the grave, which was an impossibility, the promises of his grace and his gifts in glory are going to take place also. All of heaven is ours. If you're a co-heir with Christ, it means that everything that is open to Jesus is open to you. That's what is being offered to you. Everything. Everything. Verse 33, the second to the last verse says, who will bring charge against those whom God has chosen? Satan's going to go, I know what Michael Howard did. I was there. And God said, I don't see any of that. You don't know how bad he was. I know how bad he is, by the way, because I know me. Satan does too, because he's the one that throws those temptations out. But God said, I don't see any of them, because he's covered by the blood of the Lamb. There is nothing sweeter. There's nothing that seems more improper for me to be forgiven. And yet he has forgiven me. Who will bring any charge against those God has chosen? It's God who justifies. Justified, never sinned. All charges are dropped. The last verse says, who then is the one who condemns? No one. Because there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Romans 8:28 says, there is now no condemnation for your sin if you are in Christ Jesus. But God is calling you to be conformed to the image of his Son, to be more like Christ, that no one would be left behind because of your hand. Who then condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of the Father interceding for us. He's put everything in place. And he's interceding for us today before the Father. Jesus said in John 10, my sheep hear my voice. I'll give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. And I and the Father are one, and nobody can snatch them out of my Father's hand. Listen, if you believe in Jesus Christ, you are in good hands. And if you've never believed in Jesus Christ, he's reaching out to you with that same hand today and saying, I want to hold you forever. If you've never accepted Christ, you must. Or none of the things that I talked about today will apply to you in glory. You will be those who follows after the liar, the deceiver, the one who's come to steal, kill, and destroy. And your inheritance will be his inheritance. The place prepared for the devil and his angels, hell. But if you receive Christ, that you never deserved, through God's grace will be lavishly poured out on you. And his mercy will say, it's just if you never sinned. It's just like you never sinned. All charges dropped and the hammer fell. And he said, come on in, Michael. You're worthy because of my son. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word today. I thank you for the gift of salvation. I thank you that some folks identify with Christ in laying down their life by, before this company, being baptized into that water, just like Jesus was buried in the grave and coming back out. We'll do at least one, maybe several baptisms next Sunday. And if someone hasn't responded to that, may they respond also, Lord. Because you want us to follow in the steps that you laid out. And that was the first way you started your ministry and your mission, by identifying with what you would do and then asking us to identify with you. Lord, I pray that the words that I said today, if someone is listening to them through the audio stuff, or if they're listening to them or seeing them through YouTube, or if they're listening to them in person today, would bear witness, that they would challenge everything with the Word of God, not with what they think, but what does the Bible say? That they'd challenge it with the nature of our Father in heaven, a nature that says, I created mankind and destined them to come to me. And I call them that all who would respond would be justified freely forever and ever and glorified. Tasting that today, the reality for eternity. And for those things that we're not worthy, but we receive graciously, we're grateful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you as you go.